All right, welcome back. So, in the first part, we delved into the internals, which kind of sets the baseline. And in this part, we're going to focus on control. Ideally, you want to be able to use your knowledge of internals to get the correct parallel plan that you're after, or, as we'll see, to actually get a parallel plan in many cases. So, this is about taking control and away from the optimizer, maybe not away from the optimizer, maybe helping the optimizer do a better job on your behalf. So we're going to see a few themes regarding, first of all, we're going to assume we want parallel plans, and helping the optimizer generate a parallel plan, and helping the optimizer generate the best parallel plan. So the first thing we need to understand in order to help the optimizer is how it actually decides whether to use parallel parts of a plan. And just like everything else that the optimizer does, this is a cost-based decision. So DOP, I mentioned that before, degree of parallelism. And what we saw in the prior section was DOP for execution, degree of parallelism for execution. But there are actually two DOPs. There's DOP for costing and DOP for execution. DOP for costing is used when the optimizer is coming up with plans. And what it does is it looks at how many schedulers there are. Schedulers are the logical abstraction over physical CPUs that SQL OS uses. It looks at how many schedulers there are, and then it looks at the server level max DOP setting if you have one set, or the query level max DOP setting if you have one of those set, which overrides the server level one. And it takes the minimum of the number of schedulers divided by 2 or your max DOP. And when it's coming up with its plan, there's two costs in every iterator in a query plan. There is a CPU cost and there's an IO cost. And what the optimizer does to decide whether or not to use a parallel plan is it takes a serial version of the plan, takes all the CPU costs, divides them by this DOP for costing value, then comes up with, adds a little bit of additional cost for the parallelism iterators, which might appear in the plan. And if the resultant parallel plan cost is lower than the serial plan cost, then it generates a parallel plan. Otherwise, it keeps you with a serial plan. And that's pretty much how it works. So in order to control parallel plan generation, you have to be able to control sometimes your costs. Max DOP setting is server level. It's also able to be configured by resource governor. And as mentioned, it's used both for DOP for costing and DOP for execution. You can override at the query level by using option max DOP N, which I'm betting most of you have used at some point in the past. If you've set a server level max DOP, and you've only set it at the server level, the max DOP hint at the query level can be used by any user to override either up or down, which means if you have the server level max DOP set to, let's say, 4, any user can come in and do option max DOP 6 or option max DOP 8 and get a query to run on 8 cores or 6 cores or whatever. Or, of course, they could go in the other direction, which is fine. If you want to limit your users, which I think is a good idea, to keep them from being able to go above the server level max DOP you have set, you unfortunately need to leverage resource governor. Resource governor DOPs, which you can configure at the workload group DOP cannot be overridden up. So if you have it capped at 4, that's a hard cap. No user can come in and shift it up, which is a very nice thing if you set DOP at a level to optimize for concurrency. You don't want one person to come in and destroy all that work. So again, once the CPU has been divided by the optimizer, a few other things are looked at. First of all, your CPU affinity setting influences parallelism. If you have, obviously, an affinity mask set, you can either limit the number of schedulers, which might impede that costing algorithm, or you might only have one scheduler in your affinity mask. So of course, the optimizer needs to take a quick look at the affinity mask. It considers the DOP settings at the server and query level, as mentioned. And then there's another setting called cost threshold for parallelism, which is also considered. And the cost threshold for parallelism is a setting that says that the serial version of the plan that the query optimizer comes up with during its first phase, that serial version has to exceed in cost whatever the cost threshold for parallelism is for the query optimizer to even consider moving on to a latter phase and trying the parallel plan computation that I mentioned before. Now, the cost threshold for parallelism, much like MaxDOP, has a default value that's much less than ideal. So MaxDOP, again, the default is zero, which is used all of the schedulers in the system for every parallel query. Cost threshold for parallelism, it has a default of 5, which says that for any serial plan with a cost of greater than 5, the optimizer will attempt to produce a parallel plan. The problem here is that 5 is a value that was set back in probably SQL Server 7 days, so probably in 97, 98. In 97 or 98, 5 was a pretty big number for a query cost. Query cost is based on the number of rows that are expected to run through the query. And I don't know about you, but in my databases today, I have a lot more rows than I did in my databases in 1997. Orders and orders of magnitude more rows. 5 is no longer an adequate default number. It's way too small. Today, a query of cost 5 is tiny. A query of cost 5,000 is typical in some databases. So what we want to do is we want to get parallel plans in all the places that should have parallel plans and not have parallel plans in places that shouldn't have parallel plans. Instead of controlling via MaxDOP, which is what a lot of people do, we should instead control via cost threshold for parallelism by pumping that number 5 up to something more reasonable. I would recommend at least 30 or 40. It's a better base setting. Even better than just taking my arbitrary 30 or 40 is to actually analyze some of the plans in your system, figure out what constitutes a good use case for a parallel plan in your system, look at the costs of the plans, and come up with your own custom cost threshold number to control this stuff. So anyway, once you have everything configured, you might want to use the MaxDOP query hint, as I mentioned before, MaxDOP N, and we can override up or down. So let's actually take a quick look at a demo of MaxDOP and see how it works. So we are in part 2, query MaxDOP. Here we go. I'm going to turn statistics time on. And MaxDOP is very simple. I mean, basically, there's not much to say about it, except here's the plan without the MaxDOP hint. And shockingly, here's the plan with the MaxDOP hint. Now, you all have seen this before, I'm sure. So there's nothing really to talk about here, except when do you actually use the MaxDOP hint? Now, personally, I use it very, very rarely. But I use it in places where I'm getting a parallel plan that I don't need. Just like before when I mentioned the thread skew issue, I don't want SQL Server wasting its time spinning up threads and dealing with parallelism iterators and moving data around and all the other things that have to happen in a parallel plan. I don't want that to happen unless it's necessary and unless I'm getting a benefit from it. So what I'll sometimes do is come put a MaxDOP hint into a place where the query is fast enough without parallelism. So for example, I'm going to run this query. Let's run it in serial. And let's run it in parallel first. So that ran pretty fast. I mean, I can go over the query plan, and it ran in 215 milliseconds. Now, if I run it in parallel, notice also it used 172 milliseconds of CPU time. Did I run that? Oh, sorry. Now I've forgotten what I did. OK, let's start again. So I just ran it in parallel. This would be easier. There we go. So I just ran it in parallel. And the first time it was obviously read off disk. Now the data is cached. It takes about 93 milliseconds. Now I'm going to run it in serial. And it still came back pretty fast. It came back slower, 182 milliseconds, but it used less CPU time. The other one took like 90 milliseconds of CPU time. This one only took 60. Now in my system, let's assume that my users are hitting some button on a web page and they're waiting for some results to come back. And the question I need to ask is, are they going to feel the difference or care about the difference between 90 milliseconds and 180 milliseconds? And what's the answer? Well, that's something you have to decide. For my money, probably I don't care. I would rather that more queries are able to run, and maybe they'll run a little bit more slowly if they're running like this. I want to use parallelism for my big queries that get lots and lots of activity. So what I'll sometimes do with a customer is we'll set at the server level max DOP to whatever the default we want it to be is, and run a load test and record the average times of all the queries. Then we'll set it to 1 and we'll run the same load test again at the server level. So now everything's running serially. And now we'll compare the average times of all the queries, and all the queries that are running about the same, but we're getting parallel plans when we had max DOP turned on, we'll come in and maybe put a max DOP 1 hint on those queries so as to save on resources. This is something you don't have to do if you don't have a very active database, but if you have an extremely active database with a mixed workload, this can be a very, very valuable exercise. And that's really the only time, personally, I use the max DOP hint anymore, is to set max DOP to 1, never to exceed it, because I control parallelism in other ways, using cost threshold for parallelism and using the server level and resource governor max DOP hints otherwise. So that's my feelings on the max DOP hint. Now that we've talked about that, let's discuss some other stuff. Let's talk about inhibitors. Now, assuming that you do want a parallel plan and you're not getting a parallel plan, you might want to know, why am I not getting a parallel plan? Is it a cost issue? Is it something else? Well, it could be any number of things. It could be a cost issue, or it could be one of these inhibitors. These are things that keep parallelism from occurring. There's two types of inhibitors. There's inhibitors that force a serial region in your plan. We already saw one of these, which is a query global top. That forces a serial region to occur in our plan. It's neither a good thing nor a bad thing. You know, it just is what it is. It has to be processed in serial. Likewise, query global aggregates and sequences. But also, interestingly, multi-statement T-SQL UDFs and strangely backward scan. So we already saw that there's something called a parallel scan. The parallel scan in the storage engine can be done either forward or backward, because the pages on the disk are linked using a doubly linked list. But only forward scan is supported in parallel. The reason, I'm told, is they didn't test backward scan. So anyway, those are serial regions. Now, I don't care too much about those usually, because as I said before, every plan has to have at least one serial region. But what if I want a serial plan and I can't get one at all? Well, these things on the right-hand side will keep us from having any chance of parallelism. T-SQL UDF, scalar UDF. If you use one anywhere in your query, serial plan. If you are using a CLR UDF that uses data access, serial plan. I don't see those too often, so that's probably not a big deal. Any modification of table variables, by which I mean modifying data in the table variable. That's kind of a big one. We'll see in a second. Dynamic cursors. Now, I've never tried to repro this one, because I don't know that I've ever seen a parallel cursor. So I'm not sure I care about that one, but it's on the list. There's a few built-in functions, most of which I don't care about. They're like security functions and things like that that I wouldn't expect to see in a BigQuery. And then, unfortunately, some of the newer SQL Server features also inhibit parallelism, the big one being memory-optimized tables in SQL Server 2014, which I really, really want to use for my ETL processes, but I can't, because they don't support parallelism. Luckily, Microsoft actually just announced that SQL Server 2016 memory-optimized tables will support parallelism. So that feature, all of a sudden, is going to get really, really interesting. Anyway, with that, let's take a look at some inhibitors. So, I'm going to go to AdventureWorks, and here's my plan that I'm going to call the almost fully parallel plan. Almost because, of course, we can't have a fully parallel plan. Taking some rows from big product, joining to big transaction history on the product ID, filtering on the product ID, and doing a sum. I think we already saw a similar query in an earlier demo. And we can see that the plan is almost 100% parallel, with the exception of this serial zone out here. So that's great. Now, as I mentioned, certain things will force serial zones, one of which we already saw is top. So if I inject a top into the query inside of that derived table, now I have this serial zone down here. Again, that's neither a good thing nor a bad thing. It's just something to be aware of. It's just what has to happen. Another one is a query global aggregate. So this aggregate here, notice, and this, if I run this part of the query, or if I look at the query plan, that aggregate can be processed in a parallel zone. And the reason that it can be processed in a parallel zone is because it's grouped on a set. And that set, as we saw before, can be moved around to various threads and therefore processed in parallel. This aggregate out here is ungrouped, so it's query global. All the data from all of the threads needs to be in one place in order to add up all the data from all the threads. Makes sense. So we're going to get a serial region. Again, this is neither good nor bad, but it's something to be aware of, and there it is. So we were actually able, in this case, interestingly, to get some partial aggregation. In this case, the data was partially aggregated here. It doesn't say partial aggregation, but it is. Only the hash aggregate is actually labeled that way. But the data was partially aggregated here, then finally aggregated in serial. So partial aggregation can actually shift between parallel and serial zones, in addition to being parallel and parallel, like we saw before. So there's that. Now, let's talk about a more extreme thing that can happen. I'm going to create a temp table called stuff. And I'm going to turn on actual query plan. Now I'm going to insert into stuff from my select. And it took about a second to run that. And what we can see is that although the insert itself is serial, the rest of the plan, all the way back, that's a terrible line. The rest of the plan, all the way back that way, is parallel. So we still had the benefits of parallelism for at least the select part of the plan, and then the data was serialized for insert. And that's fine. Now, there's a product called the Best Practices Analyzer, Microsoft Best Practices Analyzer. I don't know if they've updated it for a while, but a long time ago it had a rule, and every time it would find a temp table, like this one, in your code, so it would analyze all your code, and every time it found a temp table, it would give you an alert and say, you should consider changing this to a table variable. Well, let's see what happens. So here, same exact thing. I'm declaring a table variable instead of the temp table, and I'm going to insert into it. And my parallelism is gone. Parallelism was inhibited because I'm modifying data in a temp table. In a table variable. So that's something to consider. If you have big queries that are inserting data somewhere, you know, maybe for use somewhere else in your stored procedure or whatever, and you're using table variables, you could be causing yourself a world of hurt. Generally speaking, I'd recommend table variables only for input parameters to stored procedures, table value parameters, things of that nature. Aside from that, you might consider avoiding them for reasons like this. So let's do something else. Let's create a function. And this one is very complex, I know, and difficult to understand the logic of. But let me see if I can describe it. It's called return input. It takes an integer as its input, and it returns it. So pretty heady stuff, I know. But we'll play with it. Simple function, actually. The simplest possible function I can imagine. There's really nothing crazy or any reason to expect that this function of this level of simplicity would modify a query plan in any way if we used it. Yet, what I'm going to do is call return input on the sum of the actual cost from our previously parallel query. And the result, serial plan. So you might have heard that scalar functions are evil in T-SQL. They are evil in T-SQL. And this is one of the many reasons why. Why do we have a serial plan here, by the way? The reason, notice that when I view the query plan, instead of just one plan here, there's two. I have this inner plan. That's the plan for the function. And the reason that it gets its own plan is that scalar functions were implemented in SQL Server as hidden stored procedures. So effectively, what I've created here, even though it doesn't look like it, I've created a stored procedure. It's going to be called once per row. And SQL Server doesn't know how to call stored procedures in parallel. And that's the reason it inhibits parallelism in this plan. So we definitely don't want that. Now, interestingly, I wrote the same algorithm. Why is it loading my user settings? I wrote, I wrote the same algorithm in C sharp, and then it upgraded me. Great. So here's the same algorithm written in C sharp as a CLR function. So return input underscore CLR takes SQL int 32, which is an integer, as its input, returns it. That's great. And if I call that, and I'm a big fan of SQL CLR anyway, this makes me an even bigger fan, I get my parallel plan again. So if you need to do logic, and notice I only have one plan this time, not two. And the reason is that instead of calling it as a stored procedure, the call to the function gets embedded in the plan in a compute scalar, which is kind of exactly where it should be. The kind of moral of this story is if you need to operate on big sets of data and you need to reuse some kind of logic, especially heavy mathematical or string logic or something like that, SQL CLR is really where you want to look and not try to use T-SQL UDFs for that kind of thing. All right. So let's go back here. And we've talked about inhibitors. Now, once we've figured out whether or not we have any inhibitors, and we'll talk about that a little bit more in a moment, we want our parallel plan to be ideal. And I kind of alluded to this earlier. And what is an ideal parallel plan? Ideal parallelism is something that would look like this, where all of the threads, say our parallel plan has 8 worker threads, all the threads would start at almost exactly the same time, let's say. They'd all run with about the same amount of work, and they'd all shut down at about the same time. That's really what we want. And the reason that's what we want is that's what's going to give us the best possible performance, the best possible resource utilization, and the best possible balance across everything that we're putting in to our plan in terms of hardware and everything else. So that's ideal parallel processing. And there's a few things we need to consider on the road to ideal parallel processing. The first thing we want to consider is something called Amdahl's law. This is Jean Amdahl, and he came up with this algorithm. And this algorithm indicates what kind of improvement we can expect if we migrate an algorithm from serial to parallel. And that's a good question to ask. The inputs to this algorithm are the percentage of the algorithm that can be parallelized. Obviously, the more of the algorithm that we can make parallel, the better. And the number of processors on which the parallel algorithm will run. And what we'll find when we use this law is that serial areas of a process or an algorithm or a query plan is really nothing more than an algorithm in action, serial parts are limiting. And let me explain this using a metaphor of a restaurant. And our restaurant is kind of a sole proprietor sort of place. It's just run by the chef. Okay? And each time an order comes in, The chef does everything. There's four components of each plate at the restaurant. There's a meat component, a sauce component, a vegetable component, and then the chef is an artist. He likes to make everything really beautiful, so he plates everything. And each component takes 10 minutes to prepare. Okay? So the cereal version of the plan, the chef spends 10 minutes on meat, 10 minutes on sauce, 10 minutes on vegetables, 10 minutes making the plate beautiful, and the plate gets out to the diner 40 minutes later. Okay? Obviously, this isn't scaling well. The chef would like to serve more patrons, so the chef hires some cooks to help. Okay? And the cooks are going to do the meat and the sauce and the vegetables, but the chef is very serious about the artistic side, so the chef will do the plating. Okay? Now, if we plug these numbers into the algorithm, here's what happens. We have 75% of our algorithm is parallelizable. 25% will still run in serial, that 25% being the plating. The chef has hired three cooks to do the cooking in parallel. The cooks will prep the vegetable, sauce, and meat all at the same time. And when we plug the numbers in, we see that our speed-up factor is 2. So our prep time is reduced from 40 minutes to 20 minutes, but we have increased resources by 400%. That's not a great trade-off. The problem here is that we're limited by the serial part of the operation, by the serial part of the algorithm. If our chef figured out a way to split cooking up into 20 or 40 or 80 or even 1,000 parts and hired 1,000 cooks to do that work, but still had to do the plating himself, we'd still never be able to get the algorithm faster than 10 minutes. The algorithm is completely limited by the serial part. And the same is true in SQL Server. When we talk about serial zones in our parallel plans, the overall performance of your parallel plan will never get better, no matter how many CPUs you have in your SQL Server, no matter how much resources you're running that on. The parallel parts will never be able to get better than however long those serial parts are. So if we want to tune our parallel plans, we need to figure out how to eliminate the serial parts of the plan as much as possible. And this includes what I refer to as hidden serial zones, which are repartitioning exchanges. Every time your data comes into an exchange to get repartitioned, it gets put into a packet. And it only gets sent out across to another thread once the packet is full. That data, effectively, while the packet's being built, is at rest in a serial zone. So we need to learn to control this. Another thing we want to consider is algorithms. And in computer science, we define algorithms and their scalability curve using a notation called big O. And this basically tells us how well an algorithm performs as we put more and more and more data through that algorithm. I talked a little bit about this earlier with regard to sort. Now here are all of the common things that SQL Server does expressed in big O. SQL Server doesn't really do anything very secret internally. All of the algorithms it uses, with the exception of some of the column store algorithms, which are not published, but pretty much everything it does just uses very standard computer science, very well-known algorithms. And we can look up these big O's and these big O costs in any introduction to algorithms book. So for example, a table scan has what we call a linear scale, big O of n, which is to say, if we have 1,000 rows in the table, and we insert 1,000 more rows into the table, we double the size of the table scan will take about exactly twice as long, which makes perfect sense. That's table scan. Many of these other operations have what are called extra linear curves, which means that the more data you pump in, the more time relative that operation will take. The one I mentioned before, sort, big O of n times log of n, which means that a sort of 10,000 rows will take more than 10 times longer than a sort of 1,000 rows. And that's just basic computer science math, but it's something we might want to control if we can. More on that in a second. So here's a kind of problematic parallel plan. It's very typical of parallel plans I see. A lot of complexity. This plan has various serial zones embedded in the middle, which, as I mentioned, not a big fan of. Has some repartitioning occurring. It's doing a lot of work, and it's doing all of the work on behalf of this sales order header table, and then joining down here to the sales order detail table, and then pushing it through a few row number iterators or something of that nature. So that's a typical plan that we might see if we just write our query and generate it. And maybe we can control some of this stuff a little bit more. What we can do is start thinking about the problems we have. Thread skew issues, perhaps. So we have parallel scans in two places. Maybe those threads are skewed, maybe not. There's a repartitioning iterator there. So in this case, probably not, but it's possible. Costing issues. Maybe the query optimizer won't come up with a good plan or a parallel plan at all. And finally, Amdahl's law. We want to consider all these. And what we want to come up with, maybe, is something a little bit more optimal. Here's the same logic. I'll show you how to get there in a second, in a different plan shape. This plan, I rewrote the query to come up with this plan shape, uses the exact same logic, but notice instead of the repartitioning, I have only a single parallel zone. Nothing gets repartitioned. I don't have any serial zones interacting with that parallel zone, you know, breaking it up in any way. And everything actually just looks a little simpler. My friend Rob Farley came up with this idea that more beautiful plans will tend to perform better. And I kind of think that's true. If your eye perceives the plan as simple, the plan probably is simple. And simple often works better than more complex when it comes to these kinds of things. So here we've injected a little bit of beauty, if that's your thing. So anyway, how do I make this work? Well, notice instead of a hash match, I've used a nested loop at the top of this plan. And nested loops are the key to controlling parallelism and getting faster plans. Nested loops process data on a row by row basis, and they have kind of a bad reputation for something that's slow and slows, you know, makes your queries slow down and isn't good for large data sets. And that might be true in serial query plans, but in parallel query plans, leveraged properly, they can make things much faster. If we can push under a nested loop our data in the right format, we can create smaller sorts, smaller hashes, we can get better thread concurrency and better work distribution across our threads, and we can greatly reduce the need for memory, all of which is going to make for much faster plans. So how do we make this work? Well, first of all, if you think about pretty much any query, any big query in your system, think about one now if you want. Every single query has some sort of grain. And by grain, I mean like a wood grain. Some queries are about, another way to phrase this would be a topic. So every query has a grain or a topic. The topic of your query might be products. It might be customers. It might be dates. Something like that. If you think about that grain of your query, and you figure out what that is, then you can figure out a way to drive logic based on that grain and drive subsets of rows based on that grain. Now, the query optimizer is supposed to do that by virtue of repartitioning, but it doesn't really do an excellent job of it, as we've seen previously. We can do this ourselves much, much better. And we can do it with nested loops via a pattern I've come up with, which I refer to as the parallel apply pattern. And here's the parallel apply pattern. It's very simple. We select some data from a derived table X, but X is actually called on behalf of what I refer to as the driver set. The driver set is where you define subsets based on your grain. So this is where you define your products, customers, dates, or whatever it is that you're processing about. Inside of the apply, you put what I refer to as the correlated payload. So if your grain is product ID, let's say, or products, your correlated payload will say where product ID equals driver set dot product ID. The driver set will exist as a nested loop, the correlated payload will be called inside the nested loop. And by leveraging this property, we can control parallelism and control the size of operations that are done. So let's take a look at how some of this can work. All right. So first of all, I'd like to talk a little bit about costing. Here's a query. Not necessarily a very interesting query, but a query. And this query processes quite a bit of data. Here's the query plan. Now, I mentioned before cost threshold for parallelism. My cost threshold for parallelism on my laptop is cost. That's easier. 5. That's the default. Okay? So any query with a cost, any serial query with a cost of greater than 5 should be considered for parallelism. Now this query has a serial cost of 184, which is obviously a little bit higher than 5. So why am I not getting a parallel plan? Is there maybe an inhibitor somewhere here? Well, I don't see one just looking at it, but sometimes I want to test for it. Well, there's a trace flag. It's undocumented. And I often use it in development, but I don't recommend putting it in your production environment. It's trace flag 8649. And you can put it on like this. Option query trace on 8649. And what this trace flag does is it disables the costing check that occurs when generating parallel query plans, which in effect means that if your plan can in any way be generated as a parallel query plan, it will be generated as a parallel query plan. So this is a very good, quick way to find out, do I have an inhibitor here or something else, or is it just a costing issue? And when I turn this trace flag on, right away I get a parallel query plan. By the way, I kind of nicknamed this trace flag MinDop. There is no such thing as MinDop, but this effectively gets us there. So now we can see, I do in fact have the potential for a parallel query plan. And now the question becomes, why am I not just getting that by default without the trace flag? So as with anything else, it's a costing issue. And if I look at the cost here of the serial plan, it's 184.45. If I look at the cost of the parallel plan, it's 310. Why is it so high? Well, what SQL Server does, let's go back to the serial plan, once again, is it takes all of the iterators, and each iterator, here's this index seek here, for example. Each iterator has two costs, has a CPU cost and an I/O cost. So in this case, the CPU cost is 6, and the I/O cost is about 19, right? And when determining whether or not to come up with a parallel plan, the CPU cost is divided by the DOP for costing. So if I look at the parallel plan again, we go back to that seek, what we can see is the I/O cost is the same. The I/O cost is not divided, but the CPU cost has been reduced from 6 to 1.5. Okay? Because that's the DOP for costing that was used, based on the number of schedulers I have on my computer. That's fine. Unfortunately, SQL Server also has to add cost for these guys, parallelism iterators. And they're not free. They're not cheap even. They're quite expensive. The cost for this single iterator is only 5.99, which sounds like a small number, but if you consider that my CPU cost of my seek, which is the next biggest operation, has gone down only by about 4.5, 5.99 is more than enough to overwhelm the situation. So we have a costing problem on our hands here. And we could use this undocumented trace flag to fix it. Unfortunately, the undocumented trace flag, while it works, has a couple of problems. The first problem, I'm going to go over here, so I can run this query if I want here, and we can see the query runs. I'm going to go over to a different window, and I'm going to connect. So over here, I'm connected as effectively SA. Over here, I'm going to connect using a login called low access, which has low access or lower access than SA. And if I go to AdventureWorks as low access and I run this query with the trace flag, well, it actually runs. Interestingly though, low access doesn't have enough access to run this hint. So if I do this, free proc cache, and then come back over here, I get an exception. That's kind of weird, isn't it? The security check is actually done at query compile time. So what we're doing, if we put this trace flag into our production code, is potentially giving ourselves a little time bomb. Or we're forcing ourselves to give SA access to all of our callers. I don't like either of those things personally. There's another downside to this query hint. What if I want to put this query in a view, but I want to make sure the view runs in parallel? vSQL day. I can't do that. Incorrect syntax near keyword option. Query level hints are not allowed in views. They have no place in a view. They also have no place in table valued user defined functions, which are other useful things to use. So this hint just doesn't work for us, or at least it doesn't work for me. So I began thinking about this a little bit, and I realized that most of the queries that I encounter that have this kind of costing problem, need just a little bit of boost in CPU cost in order to kind of get over the hump. If we can take that division that occurs and make sure that the division always reduces the cost by enough that it will overwhelm the added cost of the parallelism operators and any cost of IO operators that might occur, we can fix this permanently. And so what I did was I came up with this function called makeParallel. And here's my makeParallel function. And what it does is it uses the number 1. Lots and lots and lots of the number 1. Well, why do I like the number 1? It's a very nice number, first of all. But it has a nice property. Number 1 divided by 2 is what? Someone's got to know what number 1 divided by 2 is. 0. Come on. We're at a computer conference. You guys have to know basic math. Number 1 divided by 2 is 0. What's the remainder? 1. Okay. What does the modulus operator, this guy, give us? It gives us the remainder of division. So here I'm cross-joining my big, huge set of number 1s to itself a bunch of times, but I'm asking for rows only where number 1 divided by 2, where the remainder of that operation is 0. Well, guess what? That's none of the rows ever. Number 1 divided by 2 will never have a remainder of 0. I know that. You know that, I hope. SQL Server doesn't know that. The query optimizer has no idea. So when I run this query, let me go ahead and create the function, and then we can test it. Select star from dbo.makeParallel. Now, the function itself just returns a single row with a null, okay? But internally, what SQL Server thinks is going to happen is that the function's going to generate that many rows. That's a lot of rows. As a result of generating that many rows, the function has an estimated cost that's quite large. And 100% of that cost is CPU time, because this function does nothing I/O related at all. So now, when SQL Server comes in to do its CPU division, it's going to divide this huge number by the dot for costing, which is going to reduce it significantly, and no matter how much other stuff is added to the plan, it's never going to exceed this huge number. That's the idea behind make parallel function. And to use it, we can do something like this. So here's my query again. And I can do select p.star from dbo.makeParallel as m, cross join, or cross apply, we'll say. I can create a derived table around the original query, and I'll call it p. So now we have m, which it returns one row, right, which is exactly what we need. So m will be called. It doesn't really do any work. It just does all estimated amounts of work because, again, none of those ones will ever result in a zero. So one row will come out of make parallel. Then the inner query will be executed, and it'll come out as p. And the result is, if I don't select that, this subtree up here, so here's the nested loop. This subtree up here is the make parallel function, which doesn't actually do any of the stuff that the query optimizer thinks it's going to do. It just kind of exits in a couple milliseconds. And this subtree down here is the original query, now in a nice parallel form, which is exactly the way I want it. So that's one way you can control costing. That's the way I control costing. There's a couple of other ways, and we can talk about that a little bit more in tomorrow's session on row goals. But anyway, that's that. Well, the other easy option is just drop cost threshold to parallelism down to, well, no, that wouldn't work in this case either, would it? So, all right, let's move on. And let's talk about scalars. Here's another weird query optimizer kind of quirk. So here's an example query, and what this query does is it takes rows from the big product table. I join it out to big transaction history on product ID, I filter on actual cost, I filter on some products, and the meat of the query really is calculating this scalar expression called some weird thing. Now, this, as I mentioned, it's called some weird thing because it really is meaningless. All I've done is put as many date operations in there as I could pack in so as to exacerbate the problem. Now, interestingly, what SQL Server does when it encounters a scalar in a parallel query plan is it tends to put the scalar out here in a serial zone. No matter what the scalar is doing, no matter how complex it is, SQL Server doesn't think that scalars are very expensive. As a matter of fact, SQL Server thinks that they are quite cheap. Now, here's the estimated number of rows. And the cost for this scalar operation, according to SQL Server, even though it's quite large and complex, is only that. So where does that cost come from? 1.1402. Well, you can see 11402 somewhere else in the plan. You can see it right down here. And so to come up with the cost for a compute scalar, SQL Server simply multiplies the estimated number of rows by 0.0000001. Very, very cheap, according to SQL Server. But I'm not sure it's actually that cheap. Let's test it out. Now, I would generally like to test against this query, but unfortunately I found that SSMS in SQL Server 2014, as it absorbs the results of this query, slows to a crawl, slows my entire laptop, making it impossible for me to get good readings from this query. So I've rewritten it in this form. So this is the actual query, and I put max around it, around the outputs of the query, so that SSMS will only get a single row back and won't slow my computer down and will get good timings. Now when I look at this, the scalar expression no longer appears, and it's because it's been moved on my behalf into there. So it's still happening. I'm not lying in any way, just to be clear. It just doesn't look exactly the same in this plan anymore, and it's still in the serial zone. So what I'm going to do is turn on actual query plan. I am going to turn on client statistics, query, include client statistics, and now let's go ahead and run it for a base test. So it ran for about 8 seconds, and we can see we got our parallel plan. So the parallelism really helps in this plan with the hash match part of the plan, but it's not helping with the aggregation part of the plan. And so my first question, let me actually just run it again to make sure we avoid any caching overhead. I don't know if that there is any in this case, but I just want to make sure, absolutely clear. It's still running, okay, it still took about 8 seconds, so no caching overhead here. My first question in this case is, does the hash match really matter that much with regard to parallelism? So maybe I would come in and put a max stop 1 hint on the plan. And when I run this version of the plan, it's running on 1 thread instead of 6, and the query slows from 8 seconds down to about 10 seconds. So, you know, the parallelism helped a little bit with the join part, but the query is not significantly faster in parallel than it is in serial. And that, you know, it's certainly not 6 times faster. I have 6 more threads. So what's the deal? Well, what we're running up against is Amdahl's law. The serial part of this plan is forcing it and limiting the amount of improvement we can have when it comes to parallelism. Another way I can look at the situation, I can bring it back to parallel, and I can comment out my scalar expression. I can just maybe make it the number 1 instead. Now when I run this, instead of taking 8 seconds, my plan took only 2 seconds. That tells me that 6 seconds of this plan is being spent out in this serial zone. Why isn't that going into a parallel zone? Because the optimizer thinks that compute scalar is a really cheap thing, even if it's not a really cheap thing. So we need to deal with this. So let's talk about the apply pattern and how we can fix some of this stuff. So back to AdventureWorks. I'm going to turn on actual query plan and client statistics once again. And let's start with a typical parallel-ish query. I've written this query once again using this max pattern so as to not slow down Management Studio. But the real query is right in here. And what it is taking some rows from big product, from big transaction history, joining on the product ID, filtering on the product ID. I'm calculating a couple of ranks partitioned by product ID and with a couple of different orders. And let's get a base run. So when I run this query, it took about 4 seconds to run. And my query plan is as follows. Rows are scanned. Well, it's a parallel scan, so it's actually a seek with range. I know this because it's a seek. It has a seek predicate. And the seek predicate includes a start and end, which means it's a range. So it's doing a range scan of that table, repartitioning the data, populating a hash table. On the probe side, it's doing another range scan, repartition, probing the hash table. Then it's taking an actual 2.5 million rows, sorting them. Now it's going to sort them broken into 6 chunks, but it's still not enough. We had a spill on this sort, as you can see. Then it's going to calculate the first rank. It's going to sort all 2.5 million rows again, and it spilled again. Then it's going to calculate the second rank, and finally the results are returned. So that's my kind of, I'll say, typical parallel query that I want to make faster. Now if we look at this query, the grain of the query should be very, very obvious. We're joining on product ID, filtering on product ID, and partitioning by product ID. Now this is obviously a contrived example for this demo, but pretty much every real query that I've worked with since I've come up with this pattern about 5 years ago has had a similar, very obvious grain. This actually works really, really well. If you start thinking about your queries, you'll be able to think of your grains as well. So, first quick question I wanted to ask is, will column store fix this? Since that's the big product, you know, Microsoft keeps pushing. So here's the column store version of my big transaction history table. And that runs around 3 seconds. So let's see. It went from 4.1 to 3.6. I wouldn't really say that fixed the problem. And of course, column store has all kinds of limitations. I wouldn't say it really makes things much better, although it did remove some of the repartitioning from the query. Not all of it, however. And the reason that this repartition is still needed, even with column store, is for this sort operator. Sort is not supported in column store yet. maybe in the next version of SQL Server. So column store doesn't work. What if we think about Amdahl's law and think about the cross-apply pattern and consider that? Now here's how the cross-apply pattern works here. I take the grain of my query, which is products, and instead of joining directly between big product and big transaction history, I move big product out. And I filter on big product out here. So I'm taking rows for big product, where product ID is between 1001 and 5001, and then for each row of big product, go into big transaction history, correlated on the outer product ID. My ranks are then calculated, same as before, but notice I don't have to partition by product ID anymore, because implicitly, each call into here has a product ID already. So now when I run that, the resultant plan does this. We've dropped from 4.1 seconds all the way down to 2.4 seconds. Well, that sounds pretty good, I think. Let's go look at the execution plan. The execution plan has a index seek on big product to get the driver set. Each row goes through this nested loop, and each inner, and then for each product, the inner side is run. So instead of one big index seek on big transaction history, we have 2017 index seeks against big transaction history. And instead of six sorts, we have 2017 sorts. And that's nice. That dropped us, as I said, from 4.1 to 2.4. But something interesting happened here that we actually can't see quite yet. That guy is a parallel scan. And if we look at the number of products we're getting, that's pretty small. I wonder, could there be a skew issue? Let's find out. I'm going to hit F4. Ah, I had six threads, but only two of them actually did any work. And one of them did twice as much work as the other one. Interesting. So how can we get rid of the skew issue? Well, what we need is some form of repartitioning, right? Ideally, few outer rows would have kicked in, but clearly that didn't happen. So let's make our own few outer rows. And what we can do is use top. So here I'm saying I want top 2 billion. That 2 billion number is the maximum integer value. I know I don't sell 2 billion products. Therefore, I know that putting top 2 billion in this query right here makes it logically identical to the prior query. I also know that top forces a serial zone, and therefore, if the rest of the query needs to be processed in parallel, I'm going to need some form of repartitioning to appear in the query. Let's go ahead and run this. Ah. We've dropped the query from 4.1 to 1 second, 4 times faster. Not bad, in my opinion. And all because of our top. So now, our parallel index seek, instead of just throwing the rows out into the query processor, goes through the top, which is effectively a no-op, but it forces the rows through. And then the rows are redistributed, in this case, using round-robin partitioning, so that after the redistribute, we have absolutely perfect thread balance, at least as far as rows are concerned. All right? So that's the basics. Now let's try something else. Remember that slow scalar expression query that I ran before? This one. Well, let's see if it works with the apply pattern. So what I'm going to do is same thing as before. Now in this case, it's big product joined to big transaction history with some filtering, and I've moved big product out here, and I put a cross apply, and there's the big query. Now, I cannot remember how long that was taking. That was taking about 8 seconds, right, previously? So let's see how long it takes now. I should have cleared out the client statistics. Now, when I run that with the apply pattern, we get this execution plan. We get a seek off big product, nested loops, and we get a seek and a top. Notice we don't have our compute scaler pushed under the into the parallel zone under the nested loop. Instead, the scaler is actually been moved out to here. And that's better than it was, because the scaler is now still in a parallel zone, but it's not fully ideal. Because ideally, again, we want to take advantage of smaller units of work, smaller sets of work. And this one forces all of that activity to occur out here, outside of the nested loop, instead of under the nested loop, where better balance can be achieved. So, interestingly, we can change that by shifting the cross apply to an outer apply. And this is the reason that I refer to this pattern not as the cross apply pattern or the outer apply pattern, but rather just the apply pattern. Either apply works, and either might be applicable in some case. Now the reason, now watch what happens when I convert the cross to an outer. Now when I convert cross to outer, and it dropped about a second off the plan, and the expression was moved down here into this compute scaler. The reason that the expression was moved down there into the compute scaler is because cross and outer have different logical meanings. Now, if the expression knows how to deal with nulls, and we're expecting some nulls on some of the columns from big transaction history, then processing it out here after the join might change the meaning of the query, because there might be some nulls that survive due to the outer join. Whereas, if we process it in here, we ensure that the logic is correct, because it will only see nulls that result from actual null values in big transaction history. And that's why we can manipulate the query optimization by moving from cross to outer. Now, of course, an outer join might miss some rows, so what we have to do is add a filter, and x dot, let's say some weird thing, let's assume that our scalar expression should never be null, is not null. That would be the correct way to fully write this query. And when I view the query plan here, a nice thing happens. The compute scalar stays where it belongs under there, and the filter, which is very cheap, is also still done in the parallel zone. So now we kind of get the best of both worlds. It's an outer apply, but with cross-apply semantic and cross-apply shape. So good stuff on that one. This, by the way, you don't need, I exacerbated the situation by making this huge, huge, huge expression. But this technique works and actually even helps, even with simple, simple things. I first found this, I was doing a couple of date add operations, very simple, on about 200 million rows. And I discovered I was able to chop 5 minutes off the query's runtime. It was still a big query. I think it was running for about 20 minutes in total. But I was able to take 5 minutes of that runtime off by exploiting this pattern, which was definitely pretty interesting, pretty enlightening. Final thing I want to show you is a slightly more complex query. Now, this is a query that I refer to as active intervals. And this is a query that I came up with initially for financial services kind of purpose, but it kind of works for any case in which you're selling product. And the idea is that if you sold something within the last N days, you're writing a report. And the report is which products have been active over the last N days. And active means that we've sold at least one unit within that time frame. So maybe we sold one unit on Monday, and today's Friday, we're running the report. We still consider that product to be active because we've sold it recently. And so our interval, in this case, we'll say is 7. A product, once it's been sold, will stay active on our report for up to 7 days. And so this query implements, this is one way, there's many ways to implement this, but this is one way to implement active intervals. And we'd like the active interval information from our big transaction history table for all the products between 1001 and 3618. Now if I run this, takes a little while to run. I believe it takes 20 or 30 seconds, actually. We start getting the intervals for each of the products, and I probably should have made this one a little faster, which we will in a second. So that runs and runs and runs. It'll be interesting to see how much faster we can make it. Okay, so that ran for 35 seconds, returned 7,000 rows. Let's take a quick look at the execution plan. And this is kind of like that typical parallel plan shape I mentioned before, where we have big sets of data, maybe not huge, but big enough, getting repartitioned here. We have another one getting repartitioned here. Then it gets repartitioned again here, even though, you know, it's been aggregated, but it still looks like it's a pretty big set of data. You know, it got shifted in this aggregate. Actually, not at all. The aggregate was ineffective. So it got repartitioned a bunch of times. We have data kind of all over the place. And everything's being done in monolithic fashion. So that's that query. Let's throw active intervals into the apply pattern. I tried it with column store, by the way, and it ran for like 5 minutes. So you definitely don't want that in this case. But let's throw big product on there. So basically what I'm doing is I've changed the query. The original version of the query just uses big transaction history. It doesn't even reference big product. Big transaction history. So interestingly, I'm adding another table to the query in order to speed it up, which is kind of a weird thing to think about. But I'm adding big product, and I'm filtering rather than in the query, I'm filtering out here. And then I've gone and I've just correlated on my outer big product everywhere in this query where I reference big transaction history. Now, when I run this, instead of running for 30 seconds, the query runs for 14 seconds. So, I don't know, maybe I'm not too happy. I went from 30 to 13. That's okay, right? Well, let's take a look at the plan. So hopefully I've hinted enough. Where do I look first to see if it's running as well as it can? Any guesses? Sorry? Are the threads equal? Yes. Once again, I have a parallel scan. Let's check it out. 1,200 rows. Ah. That was actually a serial plan. So the apply pattern, because we dropped the relative data sizes and didn't process things in monolithically, was faster even with a serial plan. I wonder what will happen if I put all 6 threads to work. Well, once again, I need repartitioning. I'm going to show you another flavor of repartitioning. I used top last time. This time I'm going to use distinct. What I'm going to ask for is I want distinct products from my big product table. However, now distinct does an aggregation, therefore forces some work to be done, and SQL Server is going to want to repartition in order to calculate it. But SQL Server knows that the product IDs in the big product table are unique because I have a primary key there. Once again, I'm going to take advantage of SQL Server's lack of mathematical knowledge. 0 divided by product ID is 0. The remainder is 0. Of course, we know that. If I add 0 to my product ID, I get the same product ID I had originally. I know that, and you know that, but once again, SQL Server doesn't know that. So it's going to go ahead and calculate the distinct set of product IDs from big product. And the filter's right down there. And when I run this, the top works too, yes. And this is running much more slowly than I expected. So something's wrong. Oh, God. Okay, so for some reason, I'm getting a spool. Let me just quickly go over to my other instance of SQL Server Sorry, I've been messing with some indexes for tomorrow's presentation, so I think I messed up my own demo. Let me just make sure there's no spool here. So this is the same thing, just on, yeah. That's what was supposed to happen. So it dropped from, where's my final trial? Anyway, it dropped from 30 seconds to, 'Okay, obviously everything's getting screwed up here. It dropped from 30 seconds to 5 seconds, and the reason being, hash partitioning added to the plan, and almost perfect row distribution. So, anyway, this is a very, very powerful technique. Something that I've used for, I don't know, probably 200 to 300 queries in the last 5 years. Some of them I've been able to bring down from 2 to 3 hours or more into tens or fives of minutes. Huge, huge gains. Go back to the office next week. Try this out. If you have any questions or any comments, I'd love to hear. I'd love to hear it. Sometimes I've heard from some people who've used this, and we've been able to have some very interesting conversations. So anyway, I hope you'll find that useful. I think that parallelism is a very interesting feature in SQL Server, and one that, if you are forward-thinking, you should definitely want to understand and leverage so that you can improve your performance. There's no reason, however, to settle for the performance that SQL Server itself will give you. You can take control. You can make your queries much faster. So thank you for joining me.